Thanks, Sally. I'm so glad you could come and share with us because it's very complicated to know what is actually happening with Obamacare. Now, before I introduce our next speaker, I just wanted to say a few words. I realize that even though I know most of you in the audience, there are a few of you who might not be familiar with me. So I'm just going to give a little brief introduction of myself. I'm Mary Ruwart. I'm the chair of Liberty International, which is the nonprofit that is putting on this conference. And there's a brochure on all of your tables about our organization, which I hope you'll take a look at. Also, I'm best known in the Liberty Movement probably for my book, Healing Our World, which I'll talk a little bit about that when I speak at lunch. And then finally, my credentials to be a speaker at this conference is that I am, by training, a research scientist with formal training in biochemistry, biophysics, and surgery. So, and 20 years in the pharmaceutical industry. In fact, I'm really excited that one of my colleagues is here today with his family, so I'm really pleased he was able to make it. So, that's me. But now, on to bigger and better. Our next speaker, John MacKey, is the co-founder and CEO, as I'm sure you know, of Whole Foods Market. And he's been, he calls himself a natural and organic grocer. He's actually built a Fortune 500 company and really set, in my opinion, set the standard, really, for these types of groceries. And he's been listed in Fortune magazine as one of the 100 best companies to work for. And of course, he might, I don't know how much he's going to share about his own contributions to health of his employees. I think he has a few slides in there on that. And so, not surprisingly, he's also one of the most admired companies. Whole Foods is one of the most admired companies. And while he's trying to help shoppers satisfy their needs and desires for quality, organic, and natural foods, he's also focused on a more conscious way of doing business. He has an organization called Conscious Capitalism that promotes the concept. And he's also the visionary for the Whole Planet Foundation to end poverty in developing nations. And a number of other really interesting, I guess you'd say, initiatives to help promote health and wellness. He's a strong believer in free market principles and has authored a New York Times and Wall Street Journal best-selling book entitled Conscious Capitalism. And of course, you can see on the screen that his Whole Foods diet is also in press. So I'd like to not take any more time. I could, again, with every speaker today, I could probably go on and on and on, but I want John MacKey to have as much time with you as possible, so I'm going to ask him to come up to the podium and thank him for coming and sharing with us.
Let's see if we can make this work. Good morning, everyone. Yeah, you want to fix the healthcare system in America? You know what to do. Get the government out of it. That's the big of all the problems. You think about the two most regulated industries we have in America, it's education and healthcare. Guess which are the two worst? And I don't really think, you know, it's kind of my, I think our healthcare system is so broken, which I'm going to show some slides to give some evidence of that, that my advice to everyone in the room, which will become clear in my presentation, is don't need it. Don't avoid it. I don't use the medical system. I mean, as to the greatest extent possible, I avoid it. So this is a new book that's coming out. Pub date is April 11th. So these are the key ideas that are going to be in the book. So consider that a commercial to buy the book when it's released. So the bottom line here is that we, let's not kid ourselves, we are actually an incredibly unhealthy nation. And obesity, heart disease, cancer, diabetes, autoimmune diseases, those diseases are primarily, they're not infectious diseases, those are dietary lifestyle diseases that we basically, we bring it upon ourselves. And we can also avoid those diseases. The best way to avoid needing medical care is to really take care of yourself. And when you do that, you can stay out of this horrible system. Oh, but of course, right now, we are pretty much exporting our own disease patterns to the rest of the world. One of America's exports now is our dietary system, our agricultural system, and the consequences of both of those. This is pretty interesting, the leading causes of death. Now, heart disease has been the leading killer for the last 100 years. And tuberculosis for a long time. I mean, the great medical advances have been antibiotics, vaccines, better sanitation to avoid these infectious diseases that used to be the major killers. Now, again, these are primarily avoidable diseases. Note, cancer is probably going to pass up heart disease sometime in the next 15 years or so. Although, it'll have to, if you combine stroke with, you know, if you consider all cardiovascular diseases, cancer won't catch it quite yet for a while. But look at the third leading cause for death. I think that's very interesting. And this is one that it's kind of like the elephant in the room that you will very seldom see people talk about. But in fact, medical care is a third leading cause of death. And you can see, the pharmaceutical industry is the biggest, most profitable industry in the world, even bigger than, or more profitable than the oil industry. So, also a little known fact. And, yeah, we take a lot of drugs in America. I mean, more than 50% of Americans are taking at least one prescription drug every single day. It's incredible. And many people are taking multiple prescription drugs every day. A lot of those 106,000 deaths are due to those unforeseen, unintended consequences of mixing your drugs together. And then if you go into a hospital, there's a good chance you're going to get something when you're in the hospital, including these sort of antibiotic resistance bugs that circulate around there. So I advise you to minimize your time in hospitals. They're not particularly healthy places. We're very fat. I'm sorry, I don't mean to embarrass anybody, but these are the facts. We are very fat, and we're getting fatter. We're up to 71% of all adults in America are overweight now, and 38% are obese. And the trend lines still haven't leveled out. And I'll show on a slide in a second, you see those trend lines. In addition, you can see that the medical cost of obesity is now up to $190 billion annually. We go back 40 or 50 years ago, we did not have an obesity problem in this nation. This is something that has occurred in my lifetime. It's fun to watch old films. You know, watch the old films, the old West. Everybody's thin. You very seldom, if they have somebody overweight, they're kind of, they're just rare. And it's just not the way it is anymore. It's not an American problem. Obesity is exploding around the world. As countries become more affluent, they begin to change their dietary patterns. They move away from the traditional foods, and they begin to eat more calorie-dense foods, which I'm going to get into in a second. Probably the saddest thing is what's happening to children. Children are becoming obese at a very young age. An incredible 70% of 12-year-old children already have the beginnings of cardiovascular disease. And 19% of children already have a dietary-related chronic condition. A few years ago, I toured this boys' camp in Arkansas that I went to for like 6 years when I was a boy. And I got to go tour it again, and now I've become, it wasn't a boys camp anymore, it was now a co-ed camp. And when I would say, well, what's really different here than it was when I was a kid, when I was going here, and they said, the infirmary. We've had to triple the size of the infirmary. And I said, well, why? And they said, so we can keep all the drugs that the kids are taking, so we can have them, so they can get their daily meds. It's like, no kids were taking meds when I was like 10 years old. Why are we getting fat? Well, because we're eating, not that we're eating more quantities, we're eating more calorie-dense food. We've increased our average calorie consumption 25%. Since 1970. So you are eating more calories, it's calories in, and if you don't burn it off, then you're gonna gain weight. So this is very interesting. This is data from the U.S. Department of Agriculture, and it, I think, explodes some myths that are out there. If you look at the single biggest changes in the way people eat that have led to this obesity crisis. Yeah, sugar's up 10%. Sugar's a bad product. I'm gonna criticize it, but it's also become sort of the scapegoat. We have this line in the book that says, while sugar deserves to be crucified, it cannot redeem all of your dietary sins. Look at the added fats and oils. That's the biggest culprit of this. We are eating so much oil. We pour it on our food. We can't even go to a restaurant. Everything is drowning in oil. And oil is the most calorie-dense food on the planet. And one tablespoon of oil has 120 calories. Two tablespoons, 240. If you're eating three or four tablespoons of oil, which you probably are, you're getting like 25 or 30% of your daily calories from vegetable oil. You can see that dairy also is up. What's interesting is fruits are up, but that's a low-calorie food, and vegetables are actually down. We eat fewer vegetables. We eat more of everything in America, but fewer vegetables, the healthiest foods that you can eat. And then refined grains. Look at those flour products, 42%. Right? So donuts and bagels white pasta. We are eating much more of those kind of foods today than we used to. Why? Why do we want these foods? And the answer is because we're basically, we've evolved. Well, think about through most of our evolution. And calorie-dense foods were extremely rare. We could not find those. I mean, you're out there foraging, you're hunter-gatherer, and you can get berries and you get some fruits. They're different even fruits than you get today, because these fruits have been hybridized to concentrate more sugar in them. A lot more fiber. If you got a wild animal, you couldn't stick it in the deep freeze. You gorged on it. You smoked and dried a little bit of it. But it was also very lean meat. It's not corn-fed beef or chickens that have been pumped up through genetic alterations to get fat, to grow extremely quickly. And salt, of course, we crave salt. We love salty things. And it's because salt was rare. You didn't live on the coast, and you getting enough salt would be a challenge for most people. A thing I would also emphasize here is the high degree of food addictions. Average person has food addictions now, and of course, you're not conscious of it. You're only conscious of your food addictions when you try to change your diet. And even then, most addicts are liars, so we rationalize it away. And when in fact, until you understand the basis of food addictions, you probably won't be able to alter your diet. Unfortunately, type 2 diabetes is rapidly on the rise. You can see that here we've got 12% of adults have been diagnosed diabetic. But we have another, this is the scary part, we have 35% are pre-diabetic. So we almost half of our adult population is pre-diabetic or diabetic. And if we look at trend lines about 25 years from now, you're going to see diabetes becoming pandemic in the United States. It's a serious problem. And you see the health complications that come along with diabetes, you know, amputations, blindness, premature death. It's a horrible disease. So cardiovascular disease, still the biggest killer. 1.5 million Americans every year are going to have a heart attack or a stroke, and more than 800,000 or 2,200 a day, about how many people died at 9/11, are dying every day from what I would argue is a completely preventable disease. Of course, cancer is what scares people the most, because that seems to be kind of random. It seems to strike anybody. And there's no one in this room that hasn't been touched by cancer, either in your own life or someone you love, someone that you know. And it so scares us. It's the big C. And it's sobering to realize that the next 27 months, more people are dying from cancer in the United States than all the wars we fought since the founding of the Republic. But here's an interesting chart. Cancer, in fact, is far more preventable than people realize. That the usual scapegoats for cancer, pollution, pesticides, chemicals you take in from your normal life, those are risk factors. But by far, there's two overwhelming risk factors. One is diet. That is the most important and the biggest risk factor. And secondly, is use of tobacco. You see, that accounts from 65 to almost 90% of all cancer can trace back to those two. If you were going to design a diet to kill people, you would feed them the standard American diet. It is absolutely a diet that kills us. It makes us fat. It makes us sick. And then we get into this medical system. We never get out of it until we're dead. It's a horrible, you can see 54% of the calories we consume aren't even real foods. They're these refined, processed garbage. We eat an amazingly high percentage of animal products at 32%. We only eat 15%, 14 to 15% of our calories are coming from like whole plant foods, whole grains, beans, vegetables, fruits, nuts and seeds. I would argue that it probably needs to be about 86%, not 14%. Naturally, I think my book is the solution. The Whole Foods Diet is basically arguing to eat 100% real foods. We're going to argue you should shut out all of the processed foods, just eliminate them. Get them out of your diet, you're poisoning yourself. And begin to eat more plants. It's not arguing for a vegan diet. I will confess that I am personally a vegan. But we believe you can eat up to about 10% of your calories in animal foods before your risk factors begin to accelerate for both heart disease and cancer. There are just two rules. It's a simple diet. Eat real foods. And secondly, eat mostly plants. Michael Pollan said it pretty well. He said, eat food, mostly plants, not too much. This is sort of a thought you can get right. We actually think you can eat a lot. That's where we differ with Michael Pollan, because if you're eating real foods, you can eat as much as you want. You don't have to worry about quantities. You can eat until you're satisfied. Every meal is one of the big payoffs. You don't have to be counting calories. You don't have to be eating little tiny portions, because this food is so dense in fiber. You basically can just eat as much as you want. Then you'll never have to worry about it again. You'll lose weight, and most of these health problems will disappear. So here's what's not a real food or a whole food. All the refined grains and flours, you just should avoid that stuff. Sugar, all concentrated sugars. There's no good sugar out there. Don't eat sugar. Oils. Beat on oils a little bit more. People, this is the thing that gets people most upset, because our addiction to fat is pretty high in our society. We like really fatty foods. And oil, though, is just like sugar. And sugar is the carbohydrate part of the whole food plan. The fat is the is the refined fat portion of it. And that's what oil is. So it doesn't have any nutrients, which I'll show you in just a minute. Pretty much you can avoid shopping at the center of a grocery store. You just can go around the perimeters, get real food. It's really all you need. Here are the bad guys. If you're like me, you see that, and you sort of like, you sort of desire it, right? You know, I've had to overcome lots of food addictions, and probably every food up there at some point or another, I'm struggling to pull out of my diet. We are sugar junkies, and it starts at a very young age. The average American consumes 23 teaspoons of added sugar per day. That's a 3-pound bag of sugar every 12 days. And one can or bottle of soda water, a cola, is about 10 teaspoons of sugar. Here we are. I'm old enough, I'm looking around the room, and other people that are older than I am can remember when I was a kid, Coke came in these little 6-ounce bottles, 6 ounces. And my parents, you could only get a Coke if you were like super well behaved. It was like a reward. If you're a good boy, we'll give you a Coke. Setting up kind of like an addiction process. But I always joke that I actually did not get that many Cokes when I was a kid. And I was even constantly not obeying my parents, and so they were withholding the drug from me. The good news is at least it seems to have finally leveled off. People are waking up. Coke's in trouble. All the, you know, I'm not saying the company's in trouble, it's just that their primary product is finally not selling, it's not growing anymore, at least in America. It's growing in the developing world, to be sure. So back to oils. If I had a little more time, I'd kind of go into the depth of how this became such a myth in our society. And the basis of it was after World War II, they did a study, and they noticed the people in southern Mediterranean countries, particularly Crete, had much lower levels of cardiovascular disease than, say, the northern Europeans or North Americans. So they went in and did an investigation. What do you think they discovered? They discovered that people there ate a lot of fruits and vegetables, ate a lot of beans, they didn't eat too much red meat, they ate a little bit of fish, and lots of fresh produce, and they used olive oil instead of butter, and they drank red wine. What was the Americans' takeaway of the Mediterranean diet? It's the olive oil and the red wine. And so we added that on. We didn't subtract anything. We just added red wine and olive oil into our diets. And those were the bad things about the Mediterranean diet, not the good things. Why eat more plants? People don't like plants. They don't like vegetables. And they don't like, they may like fruits, but they think fruits have a lot of sugar in them, so they're not going to eat them. And there's lots of evidence, which I'm going to take us through. You have the Colin Campbell's path-breaking work with the China study, when they showed in China that the rates of cancer were very low in the primarily plant-based rural areas, very high in the urban areas that were starting to eat a more standard, higher-fat diet. You've got the amazing work of Dan Buettner in the Blue Zones, which I'm going to talk more about. You've got the Ornish and Esselstyn's amazing work with reversing heart disease. So let's just dive into some of this. So I'm going to make a case against the low-carb, high-protein diets that are sort of the, they're in. And they've been in for a long time. I call it the zombie diet. Because no matter how many times the practitioners die off or it gets kind of disproven, it always comes back in another form. It's like Dr. Atkins, I will get into the Atkins case, but he was obese when he died and probably had a heart attack. And one thing, people don't realize is that what's been feeding people from all recorded history, we go back in the Paleolithic times and we don't have as good a record of what people were eating, but we know what people have been eating in historical times, and it's basically been whole food, starch-based diets, mostly plants. That's what people lived on. You can see you've got potatoes, sweet potatoes, beans, legumes of all kinds. You've got wheat and barley and oats, rye. It's fed the entire planet. In fact, there are zero known large civilizations that were based on a high animal food diet. None. You have to go out and think something like the Inuits or the Maasai, and those are very, very, they're not really a civilization or a culture, just little, small little, very low populations. And if I got into those in detail, I'd show you that they also have heart disease. So this is interesting. So since 1940, the meat consumption in the United States has increased 70%. Although, if you're good with stats, you'll see that most of that increase occurred in the 30 years from 1940 to 1970. And then in fact, meat consumption has begun to level off in the United States, actually declined. Although it's beginning to bounce back up again because paleo, the latest manifestation of the low-carb zombie diet, is becoming extremely popular. It's extremely popular among libertarians. I have no doubt there's many people in this room that are following the paleo diets. And I'm going to talk more about that in a few minutes. There's some good things I really like about the paleo diet. It's exploding everywhere. As people get more affluent, they eat more animal foods. They got to get their protein. Where do you get your protein? You got to have protein. A friend of mine wrote a book, Garth Davis, a doctor in Houston, wrote a book called Proteinholics. That people are so frightened they're not getting enough protein. The average American eats 2 to 3 times more protein than their body actually needs every day. But you can see, surprisingly, because we're kind of more of a beef nation, to find that actually pork, on a tonnage basis, is the most popular food in the world. And probably because the Chinese are big pork eaters and they are a huge part of the overall world population. Wild fish is leveled off, mostly because fish stocks are not being renewed, and so the availability is beginning to decline. Chicken and eggs are explosive growth categories, as is farm fish. But you can see, in a lot of cases here, we're looking at 4, 5, 6 times more than we were, than the world was eating just 20 or 30 years ago. We love our cheese. Cheese, I would argue, is one of the common food addictions. So people that are into cheese tend to eat it every single day. And think about it, 100 years ago, the per capita consumption of cheese in America was about 3 pounds. Now it's 33.5 pounds. I eat no cheese. Somebody out, one of you guys is eating like 67 pounds of cheese a year. You know who you are. Here's a bold statement, but I challenge you to try to refute it. All major studies show an increase in all-cause disease and death from low-carbohydrate diets. No studies of high carbohydrate diets show similar effects. So, just to give you an idea of the scope and the evidence that supports this, I'm going to show a lot of this stuff. I'll show pretty quickly. But here, the conclusion of this one, this was 17 studies, meta-analysis involving 700,000 people. Our systematic review and meta-analyses worldwide reports suggest that low-carbohydrate diets were associated with significantly higher risk of all-cause mortality in the long run. These findings support the hypothesis that the short-term benefits of low-carbohydrate diets for weight loss are potentially irrelevant. This is studies from the Harvard School of Public Health. They followed 120,000 people for 22 to 28 years. This is staggering. There's a 13% increase in the risk of dying for every 2 to 3 ounces of red meat you eat a day. So if you're eating like 8 ounces a day, then you're looking at more like a 40% increase in the risk of dying. In processed red meats, which have now been classified as a class one carcinogen, by the World Health Organization. That's a 20% increase for every 2 to 3 ounces you're eating of processed meats. Low carbohydrate protein diet was studied in Sweden, Swedish women, and it's pretty interesting. The low carbohydrate diets, high protein diets are associated with increased risk of cardiovascular disease. Here you can see the chart. Basically, the higher the protein that you're eating, the greater risk you have, or the greater risk the Swedish women had of having cardiovascular disease. Significantly higher. 1,000 plus studies now confirm that processed and red meats increase your risk of colon cancer. And plant-based diets consisting of whole grains, fruits and vegetables, legumes decrease your risk for colon cancer. Again, as a result, the World Cancer Research Fund, American Institute for Cancer Research, recommend eating primarily a plant-based diet. Here you can see the risk of cancer mortality goes up. More animal food you eat, the greater the risk that you have for cancer. A high protein diet is 4 to 5 times the risk of the low protein diet. Breast cancer. It's interesting about this. 87 countries participated in this data gathering. And the animal product consumption was correlated with 12 types of cancer with a lag of 15 to 25 years. And also, the overwhelming majority of the meat in the studies, because they were doing a lot of these developing nations, were not coming from the industrial system. They were coming from what we consider the grass-fed, pasture-raised. Here you can see the breast cancer results. You see the higher the calories from animal products, the greater the incidence of breast cancer on a 15 to 20 year lag period. It takes a while for cancer to grow in our bodies. By the time most cancers can be detected in our bodies, they've been growing for a decade. That's why it's so hard to get rid of. Once you get cancer, even when they say, hey, good news, you've taken all this chemotherapy, you're cancer free. No, you're not. Only they can't detect it in your system anymore. It doesn't mean it's not there. They just still can't detect it. But that's why most people that get cancer ultimately die from it. Most cancer takes a long time to kill you. So best thing is to strengthen our immune system so that we can fight these cancers off. How many people have heard of the blue zones before? Curious. A few of you. Well, this is a study done by actually a friend of mine, Dan Buettner, where they, working with National Geographic, they wanted to find out and document which are the longest lived peoples in the world. Who has the longest lifespans, and where do they have the most centenarians, people that live past 100. And they identified 5 places in the world. You've got Nicoya in Costa Rica, Okinawa in Japan, Icaria in Greece, Sardinia, the island of Sardinia off the coast of Italy, and very surprisingly, Loma Linda, California, which we'll get into in a minute. Oh, all of these 5 longest-lived peoples in the world, guess what they eat? They eat real foods, on the average about 10% animal food. So they're eating the whole foods diet that we're recommending in the book. Okinawans are a particularly interesting case. Now, their diets have radically changed because we have military bases in Okinawa now, and we have a lot of fast food restaurants, so McDonald's, Burger King, KFC, and Pizza Hut. And the young people now are showing the same kind of obesity and disease rates that Americans have. But the Okinawan elders, they have a very high percentage of people that live in their 90s and 100s. And for most of their lives, they eat 70% of their calories came from just one food, sweet potatoes. They were living on sweet potatoes. And a huge percentage of their total calories were coming from carbohydrates. You see, they were eating 4% of their calories from animal foods, from fish, and pork, eggs, and they weren't eating processed foods, almost no processed foods whatsoever. Seventh-day Adventists, these are the people that live in Loma Linda, California, and that's why they showed up as a blue zone. The Seventh-day Adventists are a Christian sect. There may be somebody in the room might be a Seventh-day Adventist. They have very strong health habits. They don't smoke. They don't drink. They have a community of faith. They have a lot of the attributes that go into longevity. But they also eat very healthy diets. And what's very interesting here is that the BMI, the body mass index, so the vegans have the lowest, the vegetarians the next lowest, and the omnivores have the highest, as kind of would be expected. But the vegan Adventist who didn't smoke or drink and who ate nuts and seeds, they were the longest lived cohort ever discovered on the planet. This is the longest lived peoples we know of, living in Loma Linda, California. Average males live 14 years longer than the average Caucasian American does. The females live 10 years longer. 60% lower rate of cancers, 76% lower risk of heart disease for men, and 66% for cancer for women, and 98% lower heart disease for women. It's pretty staggering statistics if you think about it. And Dean Ornish is one of the most important doctors of the last 50 years. He actually showed we could reverse heart disease. He proved it, and nobody cared. I mean, the whole medical industry is based on, not the whole industry, but it's a huge industry giving people stents and doing bypass surgeries and doing all this deep medical interventions into our bodies. And Ornish basically went out and proved that you don't need to do any of that. You can basically, even if you're an advanced person with heart disease, if you will change your diet and lifestyle, you have to get pretty radical if you're near death. A guy I know named Paul Chapman lives in Detroit, and he was being wheeled in to do a triple bypass surgery. And right before they were putting him under it, this doctor comes up to him and said, "You don't have to do this surgery if you're willing to make a radical change in your lifestyle and diet. Would you prefer to explore that before we put you out?" And he said, "Yes." And that night, he had a conversation with Caldwell Esselstyn, and went into Esselstyn's program. Esselstyn's a radical program. It's 100% plant-based, whole foods, low-fat diet. But the results of it are simply unbelievable. These are advanced people that have very advanced cardiovascular diseases. So he had 198 patients, and you can see the diet was extremely rigid and pure, but 89% of the patients did adhere to that diet, and they only had a 0.6% cardiovascular event occur in that time period. That's one person. The 11% of the patients who were non-compliant, 62% experienced a cardiovascular event in 3 years. You just got to ask, why wouldn't the 11% change? I mean, they killed them, not change their guts, but the food addictions are so deep that we want to rationalize that diet doesn't make any difference. That's what we want to believe. It doesn't make any difference. My doctor says it doesn't make any difference. So my doctors, you know, they're smart. Doctors know very, very little about nutrition and healthy eating. You kind of identify these four serious places in the world there's no cardiovascular disease in anybody. The Tarahumara Indians in Mexico, which they wrote a best-selling book about called Born to Run, because they're also those long-distance runners. Rural China, where Colin Campbell was doing his research. Uganda and Papua New Guinea Highlands. Remarkably, they're all eating very similar diets. They're mostly eating starch-based diet that has maybe a little bit of animal food in it, but not very much. Look at their cholesterol. So average cholesterol, 125. And again, it's remarkable similarities in their diets, even though they're in different parts of the world. This is an invaluable contribution by a doctor here in the United States called Joel Furman. He actually might have seen it. He's got this PBS show on all the time, and he's written about a dozen or so books, and he went in and he began to study which foods have the highest amount of nutrients per calorie. Per calorie. And the results were fascinating. And they're kind of shown here in this chart. The most nutrient-dense food you can eat, micronutrients, vitamins, minerals, and antioxidants and phytonutrients. Well, leafy greens, they're the most nutrient-dense food you can eat. Particularly things like kale, chard, collard greens. Those are like super, super healthy foods. Then all the vegetables, all the green vegetables follow next. We work our way down to beans, fruits. Then we get into nuts and seeds. And then the best of the animal foods is fish. Fish shows up as the most nutrient-dense animal food that you can eat, but still far below the other categories. It's kind of tied there with whole grains. But the interesting is the further down you go, you can see what are the least nutrient foods you can eat? Sugar, oil, refined flours. That's why I would say refined grains. At the end of the day, animal foods are real foods. I mean, if you're eating bologna, may not be, but if you're baking some fish, that's a real food. And that's going to give you a better nutrient bang for your buck than eating refined carbohydrates will be. So some people think it's all about just getting rid of the animal foods. It's not. That's secondary. The most important thing is to stop eating the junk. Stop eating the sugar, stop eating the white flour, stop eating the refined grains. Because they don't have anything in them except calories. Whereas basically, and they replace the healthy foods that we could be eating. Let's dive a little bit deeper into the low-carb diets. And I put a lot of evidence out there about the science does not support it in terms of long-term life. But you can see these are the popular low-carbohydrates diets. And that's a few decades, the Atkins, the South Beach, the Zone, Mark Hyman, Paleo, and Primal. Now here's the thing, you can lose weight on this diet. And that's why it is so attractive to people. But most of that weight loss tends to be temporary. You tend to gain it back over time. And there's one good thing about it. If you stop eating the hyper-processed carbohydrates, that is so important to do that. So if you do that, that's the redeeming grace of the low-carb diet. If it gets you off the sugar, if it gets you off the refined greens, that's its most important virtue. However, this is not the way we evolved. This is, I challenge the myth that we were a bunch of cavemen out there eating massive quantities of meat. That is I call that the paleo myth. When in fact, who are our closest genetic cousins? And it's the gorillas, the chimpanzees, and the bonobos. So the gorillas are 100% vegan. And by the way, for seeing a gorilla, they're like super big and strong. So the whole myth that, you know, real men got to eat, you know, you get this protein in, and the gorillas kick any of these guys' asses. Chimpanzees bonobos are about 95%. So mostly their type of animal foods they're getting are insects. And then when they can get hold of a bird or an egg or sometimes a monkey, they'll rip it apart and eat it. So they do get some animal foods. But again, their overall diet is very similar to what we're arguing about for the whole foods diet. In addition, their digestive systems and their teeth, which are very similar to ours, reflects the anatomy of a primarily a fruit eater, vegetable eater. That's what our digestive system is as well. So again, get the simple carbohydrates out of your diet. That's the great single virtue of the low-carb diets. But throw out the baby with the bathwater. The healthy starch foods are the fundamental basis of most of the calories we should be eating. Let's talk about paleo. Well, I got it up here. So, there's a lot of good things about paleo. People that convert to a paleo diet from the standard American diet are going to see amazing results. Because compared to the standard American diet, it's a wonder diet. It's so much superior. Because you're eating real food. The paleo diet wants you to eat real food. And that's a good thing. And they cut dairy products out, and they argue for eating lots of fruits and vegetables. So if you cut refined carbohydrates out, no sugar, no refined grains, and you're eating a lot more fruits and vegetables, you're going to lose weight, you're going to look better, and you're going to feel good. However, they're eliminating, mostly out of an ideology that the cavemen didn't eat starches, they're eliminating some of the healthiest foods that basic civilizations have been developed on. So trying to get rid of rice and corn and beans because the cavemen weren't eating those foods, although there's now a lot of archaeological evidence that in fact they were eating some starch foods, particularly tubers like potatoes and yams and wild tubers. Root vegetables have always been a heavy part of the diet humans have eaten. And then, of course, when they get rid of the starch foods, they begin to add back much larger quantities of meat that I think in the long run will not pay off based on the evidence that I put up there scientifically. Therefore, increasing the long-term risk of obesity, of heart disease, and cancer. I'm going to kind of finish up my talk by talking a little bit about what Whole Foods is doing. We don't think our government or the medical establishment is going to do anything about this. We don't put our faith in those institutions. Instead, it's going to have to be entrepreneurs. I mean, that's what we need in healthcare, by the way, too, is we get so much regulations out there, we would end up having incredible innovations. Sally was talking about like using the Airbnb and Uber as good examples. I can only imagine what would happen in healthcare if we just deregulated it and let real competition and innovation occur. It'd be astounding. We'd make more progress in the next 15 years than we probably made in the past 100 years. It would be the most amazing thing. And, but that urge to control and tell other people and mandate what other people can do seems to be sort of deep in human nature. They want, it's a little bit like, I'm going to make you eat the Whole Foods diet for your own good. That's the kind of attitudes we oftentimes have, that people need to make these choices themselves. And if we would allow true innovation to occur, we'd figure it out. But that's not being allowed to occur. So we're tackling where we can with our team members. We have about 90,000 people working for the company now. And one thing we do is we incent good health. If you work for Whole Foods, you automatically get a 20% discount. But the healthier you are, the bigger the discount you get. So if you can't smoke, that's a non-starter for additional discounts. And then it's your body mass index, so to be to get your weight down, your cholesterol levels, and your blood pressure. So you can see that I'm 63 years old. I've been platinum for 5 years in a row. So my blood pressure, I just got it tested, 111 over 60. My cholesterol is 135. My BMI is 19.5. So this diet, one reason I'm such a champion of it is it has worked really well for me personally. Here you can see that in 2016, we had 11,700 team members try to qualify, which 8,000 of them did qualify. A lot of people don't try because they know they won't get it, or they've tried in the past. If they smoke, they know they're not going to get it. And if their BMI is too high, they know they can't get it. So they just sort of self-select out. This does save our company. This is win-win. We get healthier team members, and it saves us millions of dollars a year in health costs. We spend over $200 million in health care for our team members every year. So anything that gives better health outcomes saves our company money. I'm a great believer in win-win strategies in life, in business, and in pretty much everything that we negotiate with. People will oftentimes say, this is so unfair. You're just subsidizing healthy people when that sick people need it more. I'm attacked all the time. It won't surprise you because we know where the left is on these things. I go out in public, I talk about it. You're giving discounts to the healthy people. They don't need the discounts. The sick people need bigger discounts, so they'll eat healthier food. That's the argument. It's like, yep, start your own company. You can do it that way. At Whole Foods Market, we reward outcomes. We reward progress. We incent people to get better outcomes. We don't want to incent bad behavior so that you get bigger food discounts. But we do have a program for our sick people. This is called the Total Health Immersion. We take our team members, we don't force them, it's voluntary, but if they want to, we will put them through what we call Total Health Immersion, medically supervised by doctors who are dietary lifestyle doctors. We do 4 a year, and you can see the outcomes are rather unbelievable. So 3,400 team members have now participated since we launched it in 2009. The program's a week, but you can see even in a week, people make amazing results. Here's the thing I've learned. The human body is far more resilient than we give it credit for. I mean, think, people smoke for 50 years before they kill them. I mean, that's a lot of poison the body is able to deal with for a long time. We are very resilient. When we stop poisoning ourselves, the body begins to heal rapidly, very quickly. And so that was the biggest learning I've personally taken away from Total Health Immersions. We've reversed type 2 diabetes for hundreds of people. We have hundreds of people that have lost over 100 pounds in less than a year. There's a couple examples. Here's a guy, Marty Jenkins. I mean, he's clearly obese, type 2 diabetic. Only 9 months, he lost 90 pounds. His blood pressure, he was a store team leader for one of our Sacramento, California stores. His blood pressure dropped from 156 to 96 to 115 over 75. No longer diabetic. His blood sugar is now 70 to 80. And that was in just 9 months. This guy had such amazing results, he went out and wrote a book about it called The Change. He quit Whole Foods to kind of be a wellness guru. So he's out championing this diet himself. And look, this guy, he lost 100 pounds in 12 months. He's dropped all his medications. His blood pressure and cholesterol plummeted, reversed his type 2 diabetes. I've seen this happen again and again and again and again. So let me just conclude. Our nation is overweight and it's unhealthy. And the situation is completely preventable. My goal here is not to make people feel guilty. My goal is to empower you to realize that you can take control of your health. And you can do it. And my conclusion is that the hero's journey today, in my opinion, for many people is simply to wake up and become more conscious. Then as you do that, you take control of your own life, take responsibility for your own life. This so syncs up well with basic libertarian freedom principles. You are self-responsible. No one else is to blame. You are responsible for your own life. You can make a different life for yourself if you want to. And the information is available. I'm not saying it's going to be easy. Overcoming food addictions is very challenging. Your friends don't want you to do it. Your family doesn't want you to do it because it's, in a sense, well, that puts pressure on them to do it. So they kind of want you to fail. So you also need to kind of find community support groups to help you out. I firmly believe that we could solve most of our healthcare problems in America if people would change their diet and their lifestyle. 80% of what we spend on healthcare in America are for diseases that we don't need to ever have. So with that, I will open it up for questions. Thank you.
And stimulation of the immune system, which is key to well-being?
Yeah, I mean, yes. I mean, it's sort of implicit in everything that I'm talking about. When you start eating more nutrient-dense foods, you're basically, there's two steps. First, stop poisoning yourself. The poison hurts your immune system. And secondly, when you eat more nutrient-dense foods, particularly fruits and vegetables, then you're getting so many, you're flooding your body with nutrient-dense micronutrients. And that is very powerful for the immune system. So stop poisoning, and then the right foods stimulate the healthy immune system. And frankly, the best way to ultimately beat cancer, problem is once you get cancer, it's pretty far along, but your best hope in the long term is to get your immune system. If I was to be diagnosed with cancer, I'd begin eating massive quantities of fruits and vegetables. Every single meal, I eat a ton of cruciferous vegetables because they've actually been proven to slow down and in some type of cases reverse cancers. Red beer. Yeah. You.
Not much. Yeah, me.
Yeah.
I brought the only red beer.
I like beers, so you naturally got the next question.
Well, thank you. One of the speakers I heard in 2002 talked about xenoestrogens, especially from plastic wraps and soybean oil,
yeah,
as a major source of both prostate and breast cancer. Is that something that Whole Foods Market does anything about? To how you package foods, how you sell
them? Well, it's something we're conscious of. I don't agree with that statistic, though, as I put up what I think causes most of the cancers. That's would be very much a tertiary cause, but everything should be paid attention to. So we're trying to eliminate any type of plastic contamination in the food by buying plastics that, that don't have that type of leakage. Literally, I'm drinking water out of a plastic bottle, so I'm taking a slight risk there, but yeah.
Yeah, so thank you very much for talking about what your efforts are at Whole Foods with your employees. It's one of the rare stories that the media doesn't bring up quite a bit, which is we've known for over 20 years that certain employers tend to reduce or completely erode the health inflation numbers simply by incentivizing their employees to engage in better behaviors, individual responsibility, by somebody who cares for you, your employer, who wants you to be healthy because you're more productive and you're happier and all those things. So we don't hear these messages, and it's not going into a lot of the regulations. In fact, even like wellness benefits are under attack by as being discriminatory and other things. What would you suggest to the regulatory, the legislative, and other than just leave me the heck alone, but what would you suggest as far as legislation we need to put in place to allow these employers, particularly self-insured employers, to be able to continue to do this good work?
The reason it's not publicized is that, as my friend Ed Freeman, the founder of Stakeholder Theory, says, there's a meta-narrative about business in our society. That meta-narrative is business sucks. Okay? So all stories that contradict the meta-narrative don't tend to get told. So yeah, Whole Foods is doing amazing stuff. We're doing our whole Planet Foundation is doing amazing stuff. Our whole Kids Foundation is doing amazing stuff. No media wants to write it up. Instead, they want to write dirty stories about John MacKey said Obamacare is fascism, or he said unions are like having herpes. They don't kill you, but they keep a lot of people from wanting to be your lover. Something I said back in 1990, but it's repeated again and again and again. So people here got that joke, but. Obviously, people on the left don't like that. So anything that makes business look good and heroic, you're not going to get that reported. But anything that's kind of negative about business, I mean, studies have shown like 90% of all the murders that you see on television or on movies are committed by business people. What percentage in real life do you think are committed by business people? It's less than 1%. Next time you watch a show, look who's the pet guy. It's some corporate CEOs going out and dropping radiation in the rivers. So it's what would I tell regulators? Sure, I mean, I think other corporations will do what Whole Foods is doing when they realize that it can save them a lot of money. The problem is that the radical thing, the Whole Foods diet that's what's being practiced here, that seems too radical for most people and most corporations. So if you don't eat real foods, mostly plants, it won't work. And so it's so far beyond sort of common beliefs, and people also don't want to believe and don't believe nutrition really has that much to do with their health. These are ideas that I think will be fairly commonplace in, say, 20 or 25 years. We're just a little early now. I'm counting on you to spread. Yes.
You talked about olive oils and vegetable oils being used for cooking. How do you feel about avocado oil and coconut oils as substitutes?
There are oils that are high calorie density with very few nutrients. You know, look, oil is not a poison. If you ate it half a teaspoon a day, you're going to be okay. It's just that we do way too much of it. You don't need oil. I mean, I would say that if you want to eat fats, then eat nuts and seeds and avocados. And you can make the most amazing salad dressings based on nuts and seeds and whole fruits and a little bit of water. We've got several recipes in our book. You don't need to cook with oil. You can easily saute with vegetable broth or water or wine. And you don't need the oil to, you don't need the oil. You don't need it. It's just we've gotten in the habit, we think we need it, but we don't. Coconut oil is kind of a, particularly with the paleo crowd, is a super in thing. We're selling massive quantities of coconut oil at Whole Foods Market. We're selling massive quantities of everything that has to do with paleo. Paleo is like super trendy and big. But I don't think coconut oil is any kind of miracle food. I think if you look at the nutritional density of it, it's very low. There's no, eat real foods. Take nothing away from this, stop eating a bunch of refined foods. Eat real foods. And if you get the plant-based, that's a bonus too.
Can you tell us a little bit about your company, healthcare, your health insurance plan, and how it operates in the many states that you have businesses in?
Well, Whole Foods has a, we have a company, we're self-insured. We use United Healthcare as an administrator. We also work with the UHC network, and that's a problem because if that network's maybe too broad, and UHC, United Healthcare, takes kickbacks on a lot of the referrals that they end up getting. So it's a little bit of a crony system. But still, right now, that's kind of you gotta work with somebody, and they have a reach all around the country. So we have a high deductible plan. I think it's like $3,600 now, and then it's 80%, 20% until your max amount of pocket's paid, which is about $7,600, something like that. And we have health savings accounts and health reimbursement accounts. So we use both of them. Now, interestingly enough, there are so many more regulations on HSAs compared to HRAs. Far more, I mean, 90% of our team members prefer the HRA option to an HSA option, given a free choice. Even though the HRA, health reimbursement account, is not portable. When you leave, you can't take it with you. But you can use it up before you leave. So team members who are leaving the company and have savings in the HRAs tend to go on kind of a, that's the time they do healthcare that they've been putting off for a while. So it tends to work out. But I'm definitely a big supporter of a lot, everything Sally said. I read all Sally's stuff, and she's a guru. She's got a lot of great ideas. Next question. Yes.
Fat is very satiating. I'm just curious about such a dramatic reduction in fat.
No. I'm not advocating that. I did not say, okay. I showed what, if you have advanced cardiovascular disease, you're probably advanced. You know, you've had a heart attack, or you've had a bypass surgery, you should be following something radical like Esselstyn. I'm not arguing that's the daily diet most people should eat. That's a therapeutic diet. In fact, I eat a fair quantity of fat, but it's all coming from whole food sources, nuts and seeds. I mean, everything has some fat in it. It's one of the myths. I mean, if I have a bowl of steel-cut oats in the morning, that's 13% fat right there before I put my almond milk on it. So the meal itself is probably like 20% of the calories coming from fat. Fat is not the problem. You hear a lot of arguments about fat being the devil. You know, low carb, you know, they proved low fat didn't work. Low fat didn't work because people, A, were just eating a bunch of processed foods. And you start eating all these, you know, cookies that don't have any fat in them. Well, you're not eating food. You're not eating real food. It's not avoiding fat. It's about eating whole foods, mostly plants. And then if you get a little fat from your animal foods, you'll get a little fat from vegetables as well, but we will be eating, 40% of our calories from fat. So that's that point.
Unstable families and unstable economies.
You know,
they call it stress fat. How much of this fat
do
we have to raise? It's just fat from stress
that we don't want. All
the crap we have to deal with.
Well, you're absolutely right. I mean, of course, I share those beliefs as well. The millennial generation, they don't cook. Because women, it's now a badge of pride for women to say they don't cook, okay? That's like a status thing. But men aren't picking up the slack. It's a little bit like saying, I'm a woman, I don't do housework. Well, you're going to be living in an untidy place, most likely, because you can't necessarily count on the men to pick up. Every couple works out their own stuff. I do almost all the cooking in my house. I tease my wife, let's see. I earn all the money to buy the groceries, I buy the groceries, I cook the groceries, I do all the cleanups. I'm like the food guy in my household. I had a stay-at-home mother, and she didn't let me have more than that 1 6-ounce Coke occasionally once a week when I was a good boy. Some of that's not here in America anymore, and that's a sad thing. Any other questions? Okay, thank you very much.